campus. Word on the World University Games in Kazan, just 100 days before the opening ceremony. And we travel to Australia to meet a promising star of our campus team, the swimmer David McKeon. In part two, we'll return to Sheffield, where the 1991 Universiade was held. It turned the city into something of a champion's factory. And in part three, we travel to Kaunas in Lithuania to meet a University Games hero and basketball legend, Arvydas Sabonis, who played in the Universiade of 1985. Welcome to campus. First, we pay tribute to the former Olympic champion and Universiade winner Pietro Mennea of Italy, who died last week at the age of 60. Mennea won gold in the 200 meters at the 1980 Moscow Olympics. His world record of 19.72 seconds set in Mexico City at the 1979 Universiade remained unbeaten for 16 years. Michael Johnson finally broke the mark in 1996, but it's still a European record. Pietro Mennea, who became a doctor of political science, competed in five Olympics and appeared in four consecutive 200-meter finals. The Kazan 2013 opening ceremony will take place in 100 days' time from tomorrow. Last week, the capital of Tatarstan held the rehearsal in the new 45,000-seater stadium. Meanwhile, the aquatics palace for the swimming and diving is almost finished. The World Championships will be held there in 2015. The Universiade torch relay is continuing its journey across Russia, from Vladivostok at the end of January to Khabarovsk here at the beginning of March, and on to 30 top student cities in Russia, as well as 44 municipal districts in the Republic of Tatarstan, arriving in Kazan on July the 6th. We're traveling in Australia this month, some 80 kilometers south of Sydney, to the University of Wollongong, UOW. The university has more than 30,000 students, including some 11,500 international students from more than 140 countries. In 2011, it marked the 60th anniversary of its founding. As in most of the Australian universities, sport is one of the strengths of UOW. And this is where we found the second member of our campus team, David McKeon. David McKeon is one of the five athletes we'll follow on campus right up to the Kazan University Games. He's a swimmer and he has an impressive pedigree. In 2011, he won the gold in the 400 meters freestyle at the Shenzhen Universiade. And his parents, Ron and Susie, are also former world-class swimmers. They met in 1981 at the University Games in Bucharest.
When I went to Shenzhen, it was my first time competing internationally and competing for Australia. And I didn't really know what to expect, but I knew what the kind of village and lifestyle was because of my parents.
He won the race ahead of the American Michael Clue by 0.06 of a second. David was far from being the favorite, but he'd beaten the best in the world.
Over in lane one for the final and had nothing to lose and went out and I won it from lane one. level of competition at the World University Games in 2011 was very strong. Most countries had just come off the World Championships, which were in Shanghai in China. And most countries went directly from there to the World University Games. So I think that was the level of competition was extremely high.
David was late to follow the path of his parents into the pool, but after Shenzhen, he went on to win the 2012 national title in the 400 metres freestyle and qualified for the London Olympics. 32 years earlier, his father Ron had swum in the Olympic Games in Moscow, and nowadays he's always at the pool with his son.
My father is my coach, so yes, it is very, very family-like, and it was my sister, my younger sister Emma, that got me into swimming about 3 years ago. I never really swam when I was younger. It wasn't until I was about 17. I started swimming, and it's just been progressing ever since then, and I've really enjoyed it ever since then. I don't feel any pressure at all, really. Mum and Dad never pressured me to swim, never really bothered me if I didn't swim or not. So I think coming into the sport a bit later has worked to the best of my advantage.
The university agreed that David should keep his father on as coach. And while he's studying public health, UOW is providing him with an ideal environment to pursue his swimming ambitions as well.
This university has been pretty helpful. I'm on a scholarship here, and the gym is very, and I get free entry to the pool and free gym use, and then they give me a certain amount of money each semester. Each week I swim 10 two-hour pool sessions, and then 2 1-hour Pilates sessions and 3 1-hour gym sessions each week. And I go to uni each Monday for about 2 hours, and then on a Wednesday for 2 hours. I guess definitely continuing my studies is kind of a different world, because I don't really always want to be around the pool, and I think my head would be a bit messed up if I was always concentrating on what was happening in the pool. It's something else that I have to think about, and it's not always thinking about training, and it's also thinking about that after swimming career life, and just making sure that there's something after swimming.
2 years after the Shenzhen Universiade and his gold medal there, David McKeon is looking to the future.
Kazan is one of my goals for this season. Like, there's the World Championships this year for swimming, which is the ultimate goal for swimming. They are in Spain, in Barcelona. So I would hope to be able to also go to the World University Games before that, using that as a little bit of a warm-up for the World Championships, where the best of the world will be.
David appears mature and experienced, but come 2016, he'll still only be 23 years old.
Rio is the main goal, but there's also those little steps along the way, and the World University Games is one of those steps along the way to reaching my main goal, which is performing to my best at the Rio Olympics in 2016.
David McKeon seems determined to continue the family success story in the swimming pool. In the latest news on our campus team, Wojtek Skudlacik played the All England Open this month with his teammate Lukas Moren. They put up a tremendous performance in the first round, eliminating the number 5 seeds, the Chinese pair Hong and Shen, in 3 sets. And that after saving match points. They found it tougher in round 2, going down to the Taipei pair Chen and Lu in 3 sets. Our Australian swimmer David McKeon competed in the New South Wales State Open Championships, taking second place in the 400 metres freestyle, behind the London Olympics bronze medalist, Japan's Kosuke Hagino. Yulia Zaripova is still preparing for her season in the 3,000 metres steeplechase. She didn't take part in the European Championships in Gothenburg, but as the reigning Olympic champion, she's been given a special invitation to the World Championships in Moscow in August. And our shot putter, O'Dane Richards, is training at Jamaica's University of Technology with the same goals, the Kazan Universiade and the Moscow Worlds. He sent a message to us.
Hi, I'm O'Dane Richards, 2011 World University Game Champion, student of the University of Technology. Come see me next month on campus.
After the break, we look at the legacy of the 1991 Sheffield Universiade, which turned the city into a factory of champions.
You touch, it tells. T-Touch 2 Diamonds. Tactile technology. Tissot.
Dealing with the challenges ahead requires focus, concentration, and a will to succeed. The International University Sports Federation, representing 163 countries, promotes sports values in tune with the academic spirit. Thousands of students from around the world participate in the events it organizes, and what do they learn? Friendship, integrity, cooperation, and achievement. The International University Sports Federation, excellence in mind and body.
I've been lucky to have come from a city that's sort of known as a sports city, so there's been a lot of opportunities for different sports.
I think that Sheffield does a great job of having events.
It's a city of high participation in sport. I think a lot of that came from the student games.
Situated in the heart of England, the city of Sheffield hosted the Summer University Games of 1991. And even though student sport has always been strong here, the project was a bold challenge. The games were seen as a catalyst for urban renewal.
And we were looking how we could actually regenerate the economy of Sheffield and South Yorkshire. And one of the ideas at that time was to use sport as a regenerator, as sport, as a wealth creator as well. And that really was the thinking behind our application.
The fundamental thing was the economic development due to building the facilities, then inviting people to our great city so that people understood that Sheffield was a city that was interested in development, interested in growth, and not a city that was in decline.
With a great atmosphere and thousands of local volunteers on hand, it was a huge moment for Sheffield and for the Secretary General of British Universities at that time.
We brought a very British tradition of technical organisation of sport and involving national governing bodies, the international federations, and it created a formula and a model which enabled this sport to run very well, and Fisu liked that model.
On July the 14th, the 16th Summer Universiade began, with more than 3,300 athletes from 101 countries taking part. There were 11 sports on the programme, and it all came together as planned.
It worked very hard with Fisu to ensure that the values of Fisu were incorporated into all the plans. And the development of the city to cope with and to deliver the Universiade has left a legacy that is still here today.
More than 20 years later, Ponds Forge is still one of the premier swimming venues in the UK. Megan Sylvester was junior European champion last year. Right now she has a shoulder injury and she's doing her rehab here. The physical education student wants to go to the Summer Universiade of Kazan, and Ponds Forge is the ideal place to prepare for it.
They're all great facilities, they're all getting used, and like young athletes are coming through using them. And we've just got a great base here in Sheffield.
Ellie Faulkner was brought up locally and inspired by the Olympic medalist Rebecca Adlington. She's studying sports development and coaching at Sheffield Hallam University and has a scholarship which allows her to combine her training and studying.
The university support me greatly. They give a support scheme for athletes of an elite level. And I'm on that scheme at the minute where they fund us for camps, things like that, and help us to buy the things that we weren't able to buy without their money, should we say.
The 1991 venues, Ponds Forge, Don Valley Stadium and Motorsport Arena have all played their part in Sheffield's impressive track record, delivering major sporting events. But the city wanted two more world-class venues.
We were very positive about the future. We built new facilities, and those facilities have been used ever since, so there's been a lot of sports participation, sports development, and ongoing economic development from those facilities.
Ice Sheffield was built in 2003. It's a flexible venue hosting judo and gymnastics, as well as ice sports. The English Institute of Sport, the EIS, was also built in 2003. An impressive multi-sports venue and the home of Great Britain's boxing team, which picked up three gold medals at the London Olympics. Nicola Adams made history as the first female Olympic champion, and it was here that she trained for the gold.
We've got lots of good talent, and it's a place where we can get all the athletes together, and we can all train under one roof. We can all learn from each other, and you know, we've got running tracks, we've got strength and conditioning rooms, we've got everything we need. It's fantastic. It's one of the best gyms I've seen.
Anthony Joshua only started boxing in 2008, but less than 4 years later, he would beat the Italian Olympic champion Roberto Camarelli to take the super heavyweight title at the London Olympics. The coaches of the EIS had helped him on his way to that title.
Before, I was a bad boxer. I've been here for maybe 16 months, 15 months before the Olympics, and I was like, I used to box like this. And now they made me box up and nice shots. But before, like, my hands were here, I was low, and then I was very inexperienced. And then, because I was around the best boxers here, I started to learn and gain experience. So this has been brilliant for my building up to becoming champ.
For Will Bailey, the English Institute of Sport is vital. Will got the silver medal in table tennis at the London Paralympics. For him, the EIS is a world-class venue.
I can't ask for anything more. I come into training every day and think it's special to be here. I'm very privileged to be able to train here.
Nick Matthews is a double world champion in squash. He's benefited from the support of his coach and the staff of the English Institute of Sport. He's trained here since the building opened and hopes that the staff can help prolong his career for a few more years yet.
We have psychology, we have physio, we have a massage treatment, we have video analysis, so you analyze the matches. There's so many different parts of the game that they help you with. And if you can get better, I think from maybe when I was 18 till now, I've probably got 50% better in all of those areas. And it, you know, you couldn't have done it without the expertise of that staff. You can't do it alone.
Sheffield Hallam University has sports-related places for 1,500 students, with research centres which are world leaders in their fields. The university has been credited with assisting Team GB in achieving all those Olympic medals at London 2012.
As part of the academy, we have three world-class research centres. The first one in sport engineering, Centre for Sport and Engineering Research. We have our Centre for Sport and Exercise Research, which is involved with the body and services and research into elite performance, but also physical activity. And also we have a third research centre, which is our oldest centre in actual fact, that is focused on economic impact evaluations, the Sport Industry Research Centre.
The Don Valley Stadium is to be closed as part of cost-cutting measures by the City Council. But new plans for the Don Valley Olympic Legacy Project have been unveiled. The £40 million proposal will once again propel Sheffield forward in the world of sport and health.
And we took the view that not only did we want sport in the stadium, but we also wanted to address the agendas of the 21st century about the wellness in communities.
Sheffield has great opportunities through its sports facilities in terms of the welfare, healthcare, and fitness of its citizens, all part of the legacy of the University Games.
I think what is pleasing now, some 20 odd years on, is that Sheffield, as an industrial city, as the fourth, fifth largest city in the United Kingdom, is probably one of the most physically active cities as well.
In the second half of the 20th century, Sheffield had suffered badly with the loss of the local steel and coal industries, but the vision of bringing sport to the city in a big way has helped enormously.
It's the economic and visitor economy we have created. Major events now are a regular thing for our city because of these facilities. And also now we have over 700 companies who are involved in sport and leisure in the region. So this is big business. Over £2 billion a year for this region is sport, leisure and tourism. And 20 years ago, that wasn't here.
The attraction of the university grew considerably after the 1991 World Games. Students came to Sheffield because they knew they could compete and work on their sport alongside their academic studies.
When you speak to Fisu about legacy, Sheffield will always be one of the hosting cities where they will say, you only have to look at Sheffield and see how that area in South Yorkshire has been transformed as a consequence of the World Student Games.
The International University Sports Federation, the World Student Games in Sheffield, have left the best possible example of a legacy. Sara Moreira of Portugal has become the indoor European champion over 3,000 metres. She's a student in physiotherapy at the School of Health Technology in Porto. This was her first major title, but it was clear she was destined for great things as far back as 4 years ago. At the World University Games in Belgrade, Sara Moreira achieved an impressive double by winning the 3,000 metres steeplechase and the 5,000 metres. In the 5,000, she set a Universiade record with 9 minutes, 32.62 seconds. She also won gold 1 year later in Kingston, Canada, at the World University Cross Country Championships. In part three of Campus, we'll meet the Fisu hero and legendary basketball player, Arvydas Sabonis, who won the Universiade in 1985. This month on Campus, our University Games hero is one of the best European basketball players of all time. Lithuania's Arvydas Sabonis. Olympic champion, world champion, European champion. Sabonis has won everything. He played for the USSR and then Lithuania. He's played for Valladolid, Real Madrid, and for Portland in the NBA. But his first club was Žalgiris in the city of Kaunas. And now he's back in the city as president of the Lithuanian Basketball Federation. He remembers his student days fondly, especially a day in 1985 at the Universiade in Kobe, when the USSR students beat the USA in an epic final. I remember the last shot of Komičius, of course, because it was a wow, crazy shot. I'm certain if he hadn't scored that shot, we would have killed him. But as he made it, That 1985 final was hard fought. The teams had already met in the group phase. And the USA, led by future NBA stars like Ron Harper and Chuck Person, won the game 93-88. But in the final, Lithuania's Valdemaras Komičius led his team with a game-high 30 points and hit an unbelievable three-pointer with 3 seconds remaining to give the Soviets the victory 96-93. The Universiade was a special experience for those young men living in the Soviet Union. The experience was a lot of fun. We were free. We were living in something like a campus. It was a university village. Living as students really was fun because every day something new happened. For example, we used to throw from the window condoms full of water at the security guys. But we used to ride bicycles, for example, which we never normally did. It was actually a little bit tricky because players could get injured. The Lithuania Sports University, the LSU, is based in Kaunas, the country's second city after Vilnius, the capital. With a number of world-famous sports stars coming through its ranks, the LSU is the pride of the nation. If you have the chance to study, you have to study. When I used to play, only a few people could leave the Soviet Union and see the world. Nowadays, that doesn't exist anymore, of course. You can easily go out anywhere and visit the world. So, for instance, studying languages is very important. You have to do it, and to get an education as well. Žalgiris Kaunas, the city's basketball team. The club plays regularly in the EuroLeague. And Sabonis is still part of that success, thanks to his own academy, which has provided a lot of players for the club. There are players such as Kalnietis, Makulis, Jankunas, Andres Kiavicius, all of them have come from our school. So there are some good players, maybe not as many as we would like, but at least they're busy with basketball. I think in the 21st century, you cannot only be thinking about computers, and sport is good for that. Today, Arvydas has plenty of great memories of his playing days, days that brought him so much success. The good memories are always when you win something. It's the same when we won gold in Seoul with the USSR, or when we won bronze in Barcelona with Lithuania, because we were playing for Lithuania for the first time, and we won. We won many things. 28 years after his Kobe Universiade gold, Sabonis still has a passion for his sport, and it seems it'll never stop. Next month on campus, we'll be back in Kazan with delegations from all over the world discovering the city of the World University Games. And we'll meet another member of our campus team, Olympic champion Yulia Zaripova. That's on April the 17th. Until next time.